Hello everybody, good afternoon and a very warm welcome to all of you on behalf of the Supreme Court of India Mediators at this second webinar in the virtual lecture series for continuous mediation education that started in the beginning of this year. Due to pandemic situation, we have now switched to this virtual platform. I am Sangeeta Mehrotra, a mediator since 2011. In today's webinar, my co-host will be Mrs. Manjula Gupta, a senior mediator and a practicing advocate in the Supreme Court of India. She will later deliver the vote of thanks at the end of this session. Today's topics are psychodynamics of mediation and challenges in the online mediation. If the present trend is taken into account, online dispute resolution will be the new legacy, we can say, coming out of this COVID pandemic. Now everything you see is going online: shopping, traveling, dating, marriage, divorce, etc. So acceptability is not an issue anymore. Mr. Colin Rule, global ODR pioneer, president and CEO Mediate.com, very succinctly puts it like this: in terms of India building this ecosystem, I don't think that India is missing much. I mean, the world looks to India for leadership in terms of technology. India is far ahead of the curve in understanding and having experts and decision makers within the system who know exactly what is coming around the bend. So today, I have the pleasure to introduce to you two such expert mediators who are also part of decision-making process in their own capacity: Mrs. Uma Ramanathan and Mr. Sunil Agarwal. Our first speaker is Mrs. Uma Ramanathan, who is an advocate, mediator, and mediator trainer. She is the coordinator of the Tamil Nadu Mediation and Conciliation Center, Madras High Court. She is the founder trustee and managing trustee of FCDR, that is Foundation for Comprehensive Dispute Resolution. She also authored the book, Resolve to Resolve. Mrs. Uma Ramanathan has been practicing as an advocate in Madras High Court for 29 years. She started her mediation journey in 2005, and in 2006, she was trained as a mediator by Geeta Ravindra, trainer from Virginia, USA. Later in 2007, Mrs. Uma Ramanathan also became a mediation trainer. She was certified by JAMS as a commercial mediator in September 2013. Mrs. Uma Ramanathan is a member of the panel that was constituted to draft the mediation manual brought out by the Mediation and Conciliation Project Committee, that is MCPC, Supreme Court of India. Now, I request Mrs. Uma Ramanathan to enlighten us with her great insight and lead us through the psychodynamics of mediation. Mrs. Uma Ramanathan, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Sangeeta. At the outset, I have to thank you for this privilege. All of us here are here because we are all passionate about mediation. But then when you get an opportunity to share your views or some learning that we have had, I think all of us get together. And that's why I find such a large crowd here today on a Sunday afternoon. Even though your lunch is just round the corner, everybody is ready to hear something. So that shows how important mediation has become. Now, when I was asked to share my views here, I was wondering what could be the topic, because we have heard enough about what is mediation or how it is beneficial and all that. But through this journey since 2006 as a mediator and as a trainer subsequently, what I have realized is the courts want us to get a settlement so that most of the dockets are out of the court. We also think of success in terms of settlement, because we think if we show a success rate, then we are a very good mediator. So somewhere along the way, all of us have also, I wouldn't say we have left, but a little taken a little diversion from the path of self-determination. That is primarily because we are also lawyers and we believe that we know the best for everyone. So when I was thinking about what we could do about self-determination and why, how to impress it, that how it is important, I was thinking about what is the process dynamics of mediation. Now, I'm sure all of us, yesterday also when we were talking, Sangeeta was asking me, what happens in a private mediation or in a pre-litigation mediation if the other side doesn't come? So the first challenge is getting parties to the table. Now, how many of the stakeholders, including the justice delivery system today, know what is mediation or where it can be used? Although Section 89 talks about different ADR methods, what is appropriate for mediation? When can a case be referred to mediation? How is it to be handled? Are the parties informed about what will happen in mediation? Even after all these years, we have a very nebulous state. We don't have any concrete platform to do this. Now, the virtual mediation has taken this a little further, because whatever we were taught about communication or confidentiality doesn't seem to be so secure now. We need to have something more, some more skills. So I was thinking the first challenge is to get the parties together, you know, in a space where they can relate to each other. Where earlier we were talking about a round table or somewhere where they could have eye contact, now today we have to talk about a place where they are willing to come and talk, they are prepared to share a space and listen to another. And listening to the other is more difficult here because they can either mute themselves or switch off their video, so they don't watch other things. So we have to develop a whole lot of communication skills and other things. So the first challenge is getting them together, getting them to listen, and getting them to understand that they need to participate. Once they participate, the challenge becomes what are the concessions that people are going to give. Because we always say that in a collaborative style, each one has to offer something and somewhere the pie will be enlarged. So when you want a convergence of the concessions, there must be an understanding of what has happened there or what are the possibilities and then what they could do about it. So the next challenge after this getting them together is to find out what are the concessions that they can think of. Is it something that the other person would even consider? And then how they would take it. So that if we cross these two steps, then the next step comes where they think about, am I doing the right thing? Is this safe for me? Is this the right thing for me? Will this work out? So those doubts are there. So when we have these doubts, how are they going to make a decision? So we always pitch in there and we say, no, this will suit you. You know, you'll be saving a lot of time and money. If you go on with this litigation, it will go on to the Supreme Court. It will take years to finish. A partition suit never ends. A maintenance case, you will never get money. So it's better for you to settle somewhere. But are they feeling happy about it at that point? Definitely not. We are talking about the satisfaction triangle, but we don't allow them to do because we say this will be best for you. So again, at that point, there is a security dilemma. And for them to cross over it, they must be very sure that they are doing the right thing. And for that, to move beyond that, is when they consider the possibilities, they evaluate it and come to a decision. So when we travel through these four challenges, what we understand is the first positioning comes because there are expectations. It was my father's property, so I'm going to have a share in that. My father had a prime property, so I think the value is so much. So I have an expectation. There is a sort of entitlement also, because I think as my father's son, and there are only two siblings, I am entitled to half share. There may be a loan on the property, there may be some other charge on the property, but I don't think of that. But I'm only thinking of my share, my entitlement. So what happens is, first is my expectation, then there is an entitlement, and the third one is my experiences, because my brain always starts thinking about whatever has happened in the past. So what happens is I automatically, this brother of mine, he's never reasonable. Oh, my father always favored the other person. So we always come with this baggage. When they come into that conflict space, they have already decided to take a position because of their experience, which is again based on their expectations and entitlements. So how are we? If we are going to suggest to them or we advise them and they make a decision, are they going to be happy about it? Definitely not. So then what do we do? How do we make them think? So the first thing, as I said, is getting the parties together. We have to engage them. How do we engage them? By finding out that I am a neutral person. This is a safe place. You can talk to me. And when I am talking, I will be saying something. I will be reframing it. in such a positive way that I've taken out all the negatives as a mediator. I'm going to be totally, again, that question of what is neutral will come. We'll talk about that later. But then I am a person who's standing between both of them, a sort of a referee, and I'm reframing the whole thing as a mediator. So what happens is I try to bring them to a space where they can talk. Before that, they will be hurling abuses, or they don't want to talk, or the words are so harsh that the person is only reacting, is not responding. So engaging is something more than having conversation. Engaging them is having them involved in that, making them understand that this is going to be of help to you. Now, we also have to understand that a lawyer is going to be on the other side. Yes, we will deal with them also, but at the same time, we have to engage these people and bring them to a point where they will be able to talk. And at that point, we have to realize that we also come with our own biases and our own opinions. Oh, this young couple, they've hardly stayed together for 2 months. How can they get out of this marriage? That's not our business. If they want to get out, they're going to get out. So we have to be sure that we have control over our emotions. We have control over our thoughts, and we are able to be as unbiased as possible, as neutral as possible. I don't think it's really, it's real to say that we can be totally neutral. We can't, because we will have our own opinions and we have our own judgments and we have our own theories about certain things. But as long as we don't let it affect the course of mediation, it is fine. So this engaging part comes in where, as a mediator, I am going to be as neutral as possible. I am not going to impose anything or suggest something. I am not going to twist the facts, but I am going to ensure that they get the correct facts, and then I build up by doing that. When they get more information and they are able to get clarity, what happens is their self-efficacy becomes better. They get more confidence. They are able to think. Until then, if a woman comes and says, I want so much for maintenance, I want this property, they are only thinking of that. They say, no, he is unreasonable, but you just get this for me. But then when we get more facts, what happens is they start thinking about it. Their ability to move out of that place where they have locked themselves in, to stand outside and look into that circle, becomes possible. And once that is possible, what we said about finding out opportunities and looking at them, that is the exposition part of it. They are able to collate the whole thing and able to decide what will be the best for them. So this is not an easy job. So we, in negotiation, what we talk about is the power dynamics. There are different kinds of power, referent power, reward power, and all that. But how we balance that power, how we get them to engage, how we get build their self-efficacy, how we make them to move out of that is the most important thing. So in this, Professor Waldman, I found, has said something very interesting. She says, whether you talk about evaluative or transformative or facilitator, whatever it is, she divides mediation into three different sections. And she says, she calls it three norms. She says the generating norm mediation, the educating norm mediation, and the advocating norm mediation. So she says the generating is where there is interpersonal issues and where they have their own values and standards. See, for example, in the South, they can get married to the first cousin. But if anywhere else, you cannot get married to your first cousin. Among Hindus, I'm saying. So that's a cultural thing here. So you will have to look at it. Of course, culture is accepted. So Hindu law accepts marriage here as a valid marriage in this part of South India. So we will have to go according to that. But if a person from outside this place comes, how can you get married to your first cousin? Or how can this happen? So she calls that as the generating norm mediation. She says when there are interpersonal relationships, when there is a boundary dispute between two adjacent owners, and if they decide to do it according to their convenience, then it is okay for them. Then they can do it. So that part of it she calls as relationship issues. And so when there are interpersonal issues, you will have to consider their values and their standards. The next one is the educating norm mediation, where they need complete data. What happens if it is an erection of a factory or a construction of a bridge? Then you will need to know what is the kind of building material that goes in, what is the kind of structure that was agreed to, and so many things. And so there they need to have more data and they need to have negotiation skills. So that has to be built up. And the last part is the advocating norm mediation, where they are bound strictly by statutes. You cannot go beyond that. See, if there is a question of attempt to murder, because this was referred once to mediation, if it's an attempt to murder complaint, then can you mediate that? You can't, because there's laws there for that. So when there are regulations by institutions and when there is a strict statute, you cannot do anything about it. So that is why building up the self-efficacy is very, very important. And for that, what happens is, if you see, always in any situation, conflict situation, there is an input. And because of the input, what happens is, the first thing that we do is, because of our memory, we recognize certain things and then the thought gets attached to that. And because of that, that person evaluates it and then they take a particular stand. But whereas, what our philosophy says that these are all impressions in the brain. These are all called sanskaras. So, if this input that is given in, it goes through the same, you know, memory, experience and knowledge and all that. But what happens is here, you are able to understand that each is a layer and you remove it. So, the psychodynamics here that we have to understand is that it's very, very important that we understand that they come with different superimpositions on whatever has happened. The first thing is to understand what has happened, for them to understand the core of the conflict. Then, as I said, engage them. Once you engage them, we build the self-efficacy. Once that self-efficacy is built, then they will be able to move forward. For that, the self-efficacy itself is, his name is Bandura, Albert Bandura. He has said that to be effective, there are four different factors there. There is a cognitive factor because the person has a personal goal. There is a task. I want to get this property. I want to become the manager of this place. So there is a task or there is a goal already there. There is an orientation because of which there is a positioning. Sometimes it can be values or expectancy which can motivate that person. So the first thing is cognitive. Second thing is motivational. And when there is an expectancy, what happens is I'm promised something. If I do this, then I will get a bonus. Then naturally I'm going to do it. My work output will become better. The next one is affective, that is the emotion part of it. How well am I able to cope with this? See, if this person comes here and starts bursting out in emotional tantrums, then they are not going to be able to engage at all. So first we validate their emotions. We tell them, we understand where your emotions come from. That is where the empathy comes in. We talk to them and then we slowly bring them to that point where they are motivated and then they are able to control their emotions. Once they do that, then they will be able to do the selection. So he also says that self-efficacy is very, very important, and for that we have to understand, as I said, not only the engaging part of it but also this. So when I was looking at this, I found, which I feel is very, very important for us today, there is a project called ELIAS, ELIAS, which was started by MIT CoLab and MIT Leadership. And actually it's a global venture. And a lot of people around the world have been using the leadership skills that they are able to help them out with. Even solar energy or some environment issue or something which that Indonesia, it's a different thing, you know, connecting the villages like that. So in various parts of the world, they are doing various things. But the idea came to them because this Otto Schramer, he has developed this theory U, and he says that it is very, very important to have co-sensing and cooperating. Unless we have a shared sensing, innovation cannot come about. So what happened was, because of this project, when they have a particular idea, they go to that particular country, the government, the business, the civil society, everybody is engaged. And I think that's what we have to do now for mediation. Now, we have been promoting mediation, we have been selling mediation, we have been trying to tell people how they can use it, how it is beneficial for everyone. But now we have come to a point that, yeah, mediation is there, people have accepted it, but they are still testing the waters. They don't know whether they can put their finger in, whether it will burn them or whether it will be cold. That far we have come. So now we have to make sure that it becomes an institution, it becomes a profession, and people do understand that there must be a policy and we have to be regulated and we have to carry it forward in the way that this country needs. See, each culture has a different way of approaching these things. So according to our culture, according to the grassroots level, how we can reach people and make it beneficial for all the stakeholders here. And for that, I think we should have some, this ELIAS actually is called as Emerging Leaders Innovate Across Sectors. And I think for mediation, we can start something like that here. Because their basic thing is, one is learning and mentoring. Because they feel that innovation methodology, especially now after the, you know, virtual space has come in, we need to find out what we can do to ensure confidentiality, how the communication techniques and negotiation techniques have been developed, all that is there. Actually, Jawad sent me a video yesterday of an online convocation in Madras IIT. It's as if that person is standing there. So tomorrow we may be able to get those parties in front of us, or the parties may feel that we are right in front of them. So then how do we handle it? We have to gear up ourselves up for that. And this project also thinks about infrastructure, but they don't think about infrastructure as we have been thinking about so far. They say we have to get to understand the experience outside our familiar environment. See, what has happened is the courts are there, the justice system is there, and then the mediation came as part of the, I know it was aligned to the justice delivery system because we thought we can help out those people. Now we are thinking about pre-litigation mediation also. But then we are still, you know, in the rut where we think about from the point of the justice delivery system alone. But if you are able to think of a system which is standalone, which will be able to grow on its own. So we have to think of an environment which is not familiar to us, because that change is going to be difficult. But we have to think of that environment and we have to move forward. And once we do that, we have to have a peer mentoring, because it cannot be just with this justice system. It must be other systems. As we know, the commercial disputes, we may need the chartered accountants. In the building industry, we may need engineers. So we need to train other people also. So when I will just share with you this theory U, which is itself a big topic, but I just thought this is very interesting, and we'll just, why is it not sharing? One second. I hope I have it. Now, if you can see this, he says this theory is from the right, left side, if you see downloading, he calls it as understand the past patterns. And then you go down into what is called as VOJ, is voice of judgment. Because at that point, we always make decisions. We decide this is how it is going to be. So he says the first thing is we have to suspend our judgments. And moving from voice of judgment is voice of cynicism. That is, we have to move away from our biases, move away from whatever we think is, you know, the right thing to do. So we have to redirect our thoughts, and then comes the voice of fear, because we are afraid to change, we have to let go. So he says only if you do that, there is presencing, and that is what we as mediators have to learn, because we have to learn that we have to be present. We should not impose our ideas, but once they come down from the suspending, redirecting and letting go, they will understand what they have to do. There will be a free will which move, let them go on the other side of the curve, which is letting come, and then vision and seeing what can happen. So then they will be able to look at options. So as I said, this is a huge topic, but I just wanted to introduce this, because not only is this important in the leadership sector, but it is also important in other things, because it tells us about how in any situation, if we want to handle a situation or handle a conflict, we can understand what is the decision that is making us, you know, come to conclusions. What is our judgment there? What is our cynicism about it? What is our fears there? And then we can understand and we can move to our presence. So this is the most important thing here. And I think if we are able to understand this, and we are able to, find out that we have to be there only to be present, to redirect the conversation, to reframe whatever was being said. So in a way that we engage the parties, we build up their self-efficacy so that they are able to understand what are their options, and then they move to the exposition part. And I think once we do that, what happens is, wow, their change from this expectations, entitlements and experiences goes into the exposition stage. And what this presencing that I said about, from free will to open heart and open mind. Because unless they are able to handle their emotions, unless they are able to understand why they have to do it, only then their thought process will be clear, and they will be able to choose from the opportunities available from them. once they make the choice, as Sean Connery said, it'll become doable, and then they will perform. So I think in a way, this will be the basic thing about psychodynamics of mediation. We have to understand the power dynamics between the parties. We have to understand why they are taking their positions. We should not intrude, but we must give them the free space for them to discuss. And at the same time, we have to make sure that when they have their concerns, when they have this voice of judgment or voice of cynicism or voice of fear, or when they have certain other inputs from, as we know in our country, we have external pressures on them, we have to address that also. So what I learned from this, at least, was that mediation is a constant study. We just can't say I've been trained and I can go on. It's not enough to train, as our Bar Council has now said, have a program, train the law students, train somebody else. For 5 days you do it, it's over. So then what is happening? All of us have doubts. Even after 15 years, we wonder whether we have done this correctly, whether we could have done it differently. So I think this constant learning process, as I said, something like this Elias project we have to develop. And then we also need to have something aligned with that, so that we have a peer mentoring. We have something which will enable us to at least check our bases, sound ourselves about whether we are correct or not, and also learn from others. And if we do that, I'm sure mediation is going to go to far greater heights than what it is here. Thank you for this opportunity.
Thank you, Uma. You have so aptly taken us through the steps how to get the best out of the online dispute resolution process, and then how to build up the self-efficacy in the parties so that they can have the feeling that it is doable, like you said, that it is doable. Then only when they become a shareholder in the process and they decide themselves. So for that, it is important how you said that mediation ecosystem, the mediation mindset is the thing. If we really want that mediation to come up on its own, that is the main thing.
Yeah.
So our next topic, the second topic of today's webinar, is challenges in the online mediation. Now we will see the challenges from the perspective of a judge, a mediator who has done almost 3,500 mediation cases. And here we have the opportunity to enrich ourselves with the vast practical experience of Mr. Sunil Agarwal, who has conducted mediation in about 3,500 cases with success rate of about 70%. He is the additional district and sessions judge, Delhi, and also the in charge of Delhi Mediation Center, the Sadari Courts, Delhi. After law graduation from Campus Law Center, Delhi University in 1986, Mr. Sunil Agarwal worked in the office of leading civil lawyer Sri P.S. Kuchal for 2 years. Then he joined the law department of DCM Group in 1988 and handled their property and labor matters for about 4.5 years. His journey in the judicial arena started with his joining the district judiciary in Delhi in 1992, where he held civil, criminal, and rent jurisdictions. In the year 2006, Mr. Sunil Agarwal undertook mediation training at the Sadari, and after completing his training of trainers, in 2009, he conducted various awareness, refresher, and training programs of MCPC Supreme Court.
Thank you, Sangeeta. I take this opportunity to thank the energetic and passionate team of organizers comprising of the Supreme Court mediators for inviting me to this webinar and share my thoughts on the topic of challenges to online mediation. Although online mediation is in vogue for quite some time, but it has not yet taken a concrete stage and still is an evolutionary stage. Now that I have the experience of conducting online mediations only of five and a half months, when the courts had to suddenly close due to corona pandemic, and thereafter gradually these system was partially opened. The mediation center also opened say in the middle of May 2020, and we slowly began with the online mediations. Initially we started with the calling the parties in pending matters, whether they are interested in participating in online mediations, and we found certain challenges at that end also. Thereafter we had our experience in conducting mediations, and to my today's deliberation is purely based on my own experience in conducting online mediation and the feedback and discussions I had with the advocate mediators of my mediation center. Therefore, these thoughts are not based on any research paper or whatever raw thoughts I will be sharing with you. These, whatever challenges we have faced in conducting the online mediations. You see, the online mediation cannot be a qualitative substitute of offline mediation. There always remain challenge of assessing the body language or the tone and tenor, pitch of the voice. All things, we cannot really assess the entire personality and personal cues of a party. Nevertheless, I have outlined some of the challenges that we have faced in conducting mediations right from May onwards till today. Some of the mediators of Supreme Court mediation centers, we were fortunate to have them on board in the online mediations, and they must be having those experiences themselves. Now, I have divided these challenges into two parts, internal challenges and those were external challenges. The internal challenges mean the issues that crop up after the parties join an online mediation. I would outline these internal challenges starting from the first, towards competence. Competence of mediator. The mediator for an online mediation need not be competent or knowledgeable in the subject that he is going to mediate, but he should also be competent and comfortable in handling the tools and technology that he is conducting mediation through. Therefore, he should himself have good connectivity, audibility, visibility. He needs to check with the parties. These are only basic things, but you see, these are all concerned with the mediation. Unless and until we check all these things, there can't be both ways communication. So therefore, the mediator in an online mediation needs not only to be a good moderator, but also a technical advisor. So he, unless and until he himself has some, at least slight technical knowledge by working on the system for quite some time, so that he be able to advise the parties on the other side, parties or maybe at times councils on the other side, as to how to join the meeting. Then at times a plan B should also be in mind, because the bandwidth goes low at many a times. Then a plan B, like joining through a telephone, should be there. At least the party will be able to hear the or listen to the proceedings in the online mediation. Then the next crucial issue is of confidentiality. how to maintain the confidentiality of a mediation process in an online mode. In the offline mode, we can ensure that the parties switch off their mobile phones or do not use any equipment for recording the camera, but recording the proceedings. But in an online mode, when all parties are sitting at different places, at various separate places, how can it be ensured that the entire proceedings remain confidential? Because we don't know whether they have applied some technique to record the entire proceedings, or maybe taking the shots through their mobile phones or a camera. But what we have practiced at Delhi Mediation Center is that we send a word in the meeting link itself that the proceedings are entirely confidential and that no audio or video recording is, all audio and video recordings are prohibited, and doing otherwise or breach of this term may entail consequences. I do not know what can be the possible consequences, because mediation and conciliation rules do not provide any adverse consequences, but we have taken care to interact with the referral judges also, because we are a court annexed mediation center. So whenever we are interacting with the referral judges, we have been emphasizing and making it sure that the judicial officers, whenever come across these kind of evidences which they have taken down during a mediation proceedings, they should abhor such kind of evidence, and they should rather desist and repel the parties from taking this evidence in board, and the such parties should be taken to task in their own way. The next step, we are at the beginning and at the introduction or the opening comments also, we have been ensuring and we have been highlighting that these proceedings are entirely confidential and there should not be any video or audio recording by the parties. We have also started taking written commitment from the parties that they have not taken any video or audio recordings, and that whatever documents have been shared will also not be utilized anywhere else. Once the other kind of confidentiality is sense, we do not know whether the parties or the councils have shared the meeting link with how many persons. Therefore, as soon as the necessary parties join the meeting, we lock the room. There is a provision of locking the room. We have started from the video application or video platform, but since it was not having all the features necessary for conducting an online mediation, we shifted to WebEx, Cisco WebEx platform. And nowadays, Cisco WebEx platform is being used in the High Court as well as in the District Courts of Delhi. So the Cisco WebEx has a feature of locking the room as and when you the parties have entered in. But you see, sometimes the parties join from another instrument, join the meeting from another instrument. Then they come into the room. If you have sent one party to a lobby or the waiting room, that waiting party sometimes join through a different instrument. And the mediator then has to check and keep his eyes open that no such party enters and the private talks being taken place in caucus should not be interfered or that shared with that party. So he should therefore immediately request that party to please go to the waiting room. Then there are, you see, in many, the next internal challenge would be the communication skills. The communication skills, we all know that right now we are talking in online mode, but we don't know whether each person has a different angle of his camera. Each person is although maybe looking in the camera, but from a different angle. Therefore, we should inculcate or create a new language of talk in conducting mediation proceedings. We should initially agree to address each other with first name or maybe with the nickname, or say Mr. Arora, Mr. Gupta, and like this, so that the concerned person immediately comes to know that he is being asked something or he is being addressed. Therefore, the effectiveness of a cyber mediation is challenged by lack of established personal connection of parties. Because there is no personal connection. At times, the parties may not have met before the dispute has arisen. Therefore, there is no personal connection or though no emotional touch between these parties. And it is a challenging task in such a situation for the mediator to build trust in such parties who have not met earlier. The authority of mediator in effectively controlling the mediation also gets reduced, also gets impeded in such circumstances. So these are the broad challenges of mediation. And the emotions also do not come out exactly the way in which they come out in offline mode, because people know that they are before a camera and they control their emotions accordingly. One thing I would also like to say that sometimes parties go on speaking monotonously and do not stop, and it does not sound good to interject them in between. Therefore, it should be addressed at the beginning itself or while setting the ground rules that the party should be comprehensive and brief. And so that because these meetings are generally time bound and these have to finish within that time bound, or the parties or the mediator may have another mediation waiting for him after a set time. Another important aspect of communication is that when one of the parties has been sent to lobby or the waiting room, because it is an online setting, he is practically seeing a wall in his front. So therefore, say he has been sent to lobby for 10 minutes or 15 minutes. So 10 or 15 minutes are too long to face a wall. And people get restless, and we have the experience that some of the parties leave the room, leave the meeting itself. Therefore, it is necessary and it is quite essential to ensure the parties and to reiterate to the parties before that time gets over that please wait for more two or four more minutes, and we are taking you in the meeting within that time. Please, and you will also be given so much of time in single session. So these are only the practical aspects. Then after the communication skill, there are some distractions also during online mediation. Like most of the people nowadays are conducting mediations either through iPad or from their mobile phones. And the mobile phone continuously is getting text or messages in one way or the other, or the mails, and they get distracted. And some of the such messages also appear to be so important, and they just distracting from the mediation proceedings, they open the mail and engage themselves that way. We have also seen that some of the parties or even the lawyers, they join from moving vehicles. So, although they may not be driving themselves, but they may distract some other person by talking from the moving vehicles. If they are joining from a moving train, then it may be okay, but from joining from a four-wheeler may sometimes be hazardous. Therefore, whenever we see that the person is in a car, we request him to please stop the car on his side, wherever he may find space, and then we continue with the mediation proceedings, or the proceedings then are adjourned to some other date. And you see, such type of moving vehicles also create distractions because of outside noise also, because the horns keep honking and disturb the entire proceedings. So far as distractions are concerned, parties also creates self distractions sometimes. By exhibiting their passiveness towards the proceedings or defiance towards negotiations. It sometimes becomes difficult for the mediator to pick on a party disengaging in the online session and thereby impeding the productive negotiations. So these are the some barriers, but we can understand these are not so deep that they can't be overcome. They can be overcome with slight suggestions or slight advisory to the parties. The next internal barrier or challenge is the settlement writing. The settlement writing has not yet been settled finally, but what we have done in this interregnum, I can share with you that we had started with the, after finalizing the terms with the parties, we used to prepare the draft and share with the parties. After it is finalized, we would request them, we sent them through email and requesting them to annex their signatures or append their signatures and post the signed settlements to us through speed post, because post and telegraph department had partially opened by that time. Initially it worked good, but as soon as more activities were getting opened, we got jumbled up with those mails, those posts, because even if the post department was open, but it was only partial, and we were getting mails maybe after the speed post, which is supposed to be delivered within 24 or 48 hours, we used to get it within after 7 to 14 days, or maybe after 20 days in some cases. Even from Faridabad, situated 20-30 kilometers away from Delhi, we received mails after 20-22 days. Thereafter, we then gave it up. Then we started with the mail system, that you send us the, you put your signatures, scan those copies and mail us. But nowadays we have been doing like this. We have created a dedicated email of our mediation center on which all our mails are received, and we have been sending mails from that email address. But you see, the gray area still remains about the final acceptability of the mediation settlement. It will work good till when the parties affirm those terms before the court or do not dispute the terms anywhere. But wherever a question arises, then the problem arises. Now, its fallout we will be seeing in the external challenges. So then, it is while drafting the settlements, we have been doing after the terms have been finalized by the parties or the terms have been worked out by the parties, we prepare a draft, say on the same date after 2 hours or in the evening. Then the draft is directly screen shared with all the parties, two parties or maybe more parties. Then what I do is, with the screen sharing, whatever modifications or alterations are required, I directly effect those alterations subject to consent of all the concerned parties. Directly the changes are affected and the draft is, the settlement is finalized there and then. Unless some more inputs are to be taken or some more figures, maybe sometimes some figures or say parties have to give their account number or the PAN number, and those details are not immediately available with them, then only those parts are left out so that are to be supplied later on. And after, as soon as the meeting is over with this finalized settlement, these are immediately posted at their email addresses with a request to take their printout, please put their signatures, then send us the scanned copies on our email. And those are almost immediately or by the next day, we have been sending to the court. So these were broadly the internal challenges. So far as the external challenges are concerned, the external challenges are those which are actually not within the jurisdiction of a mediator, or which may make the online mediation difficult at times. To list these external factors is, I would start with the availability of connectivity, so that a seamless mediation proceedings can be held. And before that, or connected with this, is the availability of hardware and software with the people to whom we are going to extend these mediation proceedings or online mediation proceedings. Since we are working at district courts, we are faced with many, many cases in which the parties don't have the Android phone, or therefore they either don't have the Android phone nor have the cyber cafe nearby. Also, of course, they also don't have the laptop, etc. The connectivity is also a major issue because of lack of a robust internet infrastructure. People are unable to join, and this difficulty is generally in the rural areas where the connectivity is too poor. Coupled with this factor is the lack of confidence of people in online proceedings. They are not averse, not only to mediation. They are averse to everything online. They do not indulge in online commerce. They do not purchase anything online because of their lack of confidence. They don't trust that these things really work. So I think awareness needs to be made to those people, and slowly it is working also. In May 2020, when we had called up various people in pending cases, in 800 cases, we had received good response or positive response for online mediation only in 20 cases out of 800 cases, we had called up each and every party, each and every advocate of those parties, and took consent and strived to take consent of all those parties, and could manage only 20 cases. And slowly, when the courts also were working online, we started receiving reverse requests from the parties and councils, please take our cases online. Then gradually the momentum took place, and many more parties started coming. Now, the next external challenge would be the development of expertise. You see, as human beings, we are resistant to change. We resist every change and do not want to come out of our comfort level. When the online mediation was put on vogue, all our mediators were not so comfortable with the idea of getting trained for conducting online mediations. But nevertheless, we imparted training to all. But you see, everyone without a passion can't get trained equally. Those who had worked with themselves better, and we had requested them that after the training, they conduct mediation conferences within their house to have an experience, within themselves to have an experience. And some of them were very, very good. So initially, we started with very few mediators. And of course, we also had very few cases. Then, and we also started with easiest of the cases, because we ourselves were apprehensive whether it is going to work or not. And I would quite fairly share with you that when abruptly we were put on online mode, because of lack of our knowledge towards the system and how it will work out, and we were, ourselves were apprehensive, some of the although very few, but some of the cases got not settled. Although I am sure that in offline mode, those had good potential of getting settled. But maybe because of our lack of knowledge, of our lack of orientation, those did not click. And likewise happened with the other mediators also. With the passage of time, or gradually the mediators and the our staff also gained the experience and gained the knowledge about how to conduct a mediation. And nowadays, a good number of our mediators have been hosting the mediation meetings themselves. We are just passing on the necessary details to or the contact details of the parties, and telling them about the outer dates fixed by the court. But they themselves have been conducting the hosting the meetings, first meeting, and maybe if they are deferred meetings also, they are themselves conducting these meetings. And of course, they are sharing whatever proceedings have taken place at the end of the with the mediation center. There also happened to be a situation that whenever earlier we used to send the meeting messages or meeting links to the parties, say the matter has been fixed for 7 days hereafter, for the next Sunday, we used to immediately set a meeting at the system and send the meeting link today itself. But we realized after some time that people are getting so many messages, so many WhatsApp messages or emails, that those meeting links were getting pushed by number of other messages, and people were forgetting about the meetings, because nowadays there is no system of taking down the every meeting or every link at in the diary. People are not maintaining diaries, therefore they were losing these links, and we then had to, at the appointed hour, we had to again contact them, again send them meeting links, and then therefore the precious time was lost. Nowadays we send them meeting link either 12 hours before the meeting, or maybe one day before the meeting, so that it remains fresh in the mind of concerned parties and of course the lawyers. We have also resorted to hybrid mediation also. Just as I was saying that people don't have the hardware and software, but the lawyers have made the online mediation possible in such cases. They call the parties either to their office or to their chambers in the court complex and join online from there. Parties sitting on the one side and lawyer sitting on the other side, of course, by keeping the social distance. So the lawyers have actually been helping in this manner. But the other external challenge pertains to the lawyer and their clients as well. Slowly, some issues of the clients asking their lawyers to reduce fee are cropping up because of online mediation, because they are saying that you are not going to undertake travel, you are not spending, you are saving on your time, therefore fee should be reduced. The lawyer on his part is also saying that you also have been spared of the costs and time of travel, and therefore why should the lawyer only do the entire sacrifice? So we understand that over a period of time these all things will be worked out and all will set in place. Then the other external challenges I was referring to while considering the settlement writing. That settlement writing is a gray area. Wherever a question will arise, or wherever one party will dispute the terms of settlement, we don't know whether the court is going to accept it or not, because the Information Technology Act, although contains a provision, yet it doesn't seem to be so forceful as to compel the parties to accept that settlement. Because after all, the signed settlement remains in the parties' hands, and only the copies are exchanged with us, and those copies we are forwarding to the court. And court has only that maybe copy to copy or third copy or fourth copy the court is having. Therefore, there is a greater and most urgent need to have a legislative recognition for this entire process. And until the legislative recognition comes into being, there should be some judicial recognition, so that online proceedings do not get derailed. Till date, I have not experienced any such derailment, because the parties are maintaining with the settlements, but you can't rule out the possibilities. And the last external challenge to my mind will be the invasion of artificial intelligence. We are noticing that artificial intelligence is everywhere. The artificial intelligence has taken over the automatic negotiations on behalf of e-commerce companies. And I was reading an article the other day that in China, in Guangzhou, there is a automated quote where the matter is negotiated by the computer, and the matters are getting decided or settled by the computer. And the so far within say 2.5 years, that court has those courts, there are many courts in that state, those courts have settled 3 million cases. We although artificial intelligence is helpful and will make it easy for human beings to conduct themselves, but it may also have the effect, ultimate effect of evading the human beings altogether. So we will have to keep a check. Now, at the end of my presentation, I would say that we should be prepared to change. And it is not very difficult to change. You see, if we do not synchronize ourselves to the present times, the saying of Benjamin Franklin that by failing to prepare, you are preparing to fail, may hold good. Right. Thank you so much.
Now we have seen how Mr. Sunil Agarwal have taken us through the challenges he is facing, which are, he said that it is not insurmountable. There is a question I have seen in other WhatsApp group also, because you are in charge, that is why I think you can answer this. Why not using Zoom platform? Because everywhere I have seen there is overwhelming this thing. I mean, the mediators, they are saying that Zoom platform is very good. Then why not our courts not using Zoom platform?
Thank you for the question, ma'am. We are a court annexed mediation center and part of District Courts of Delhi. Since there was an advisory of Ministry of Home Affairs against Zoom platform, therefore the entire in the entire country, the courts have abhorred the Zoom system, and right from the Honorable Supreme Court of India, that was earlier using the video platform and may have shifted to Cisco WebEx. Delhi High Court and Delhi District Courts are using only the Cisco WebEx platform. Cisco. And we have found it to be equally good.
Okay. So that answers the question. There are some more questions. Should I put before it or? Hello. Manjula, you have to unmute.
There is one question.
Yes.
For Ms. Uma Ramanathan. Ma'am, this is for you. Is mediator expected to ensure fair settlement agreement as against a settlement agreement? If yes, how does he do that? Further, is he required to strike the power balance between the parties? This is from Vipin Agarwal. Then there is no voice. You have to unmute yourself.
Sorry. Thank you. It is a very good question. As a lawyer, being trained as a lawyer, we know what is the law in that situation. And so we always tend to think, why are parties accepting this? But then in mediation, I think for various reasons, if they are prepared to accept something and walk away, it is up to them. But the point is, when they are doing the negotiation, we have to ensure that there is a power balance. That is why we say it is an informed consent. See, unless they know what is the opportunity they have and they willingly give it, that is why this theory you is very, very interesting. That when they come into the point where their free will is operating, they understand and they give up. For various reasons, they may give up. See, out of frustration doing it or being coerced by an unfair party. See, for example, in a matrimonial dispute where the parties were talking about division of the property and maintenance and all that, I spoke to the daughter and I found out that she had been sexually abused by the father. And the mother was prepared to accept certain things because she wanted to walk out of the house. I mean, she had walked out. She wanted to settle the whole thing. But I felt it was not fair at that point because the daughter's needs were not addressed at all. So sometimes as a mediator, we have to take a call. The settlement alone is not the whole thing. It is about the party's understanding. See, some of our judges have told me, see, you people have not been able to settle, but when it comes back to us, it settles. And I always tell them it is because we changed their mindset. And they were in the frame of mind where they wanted somebody to say, yes, this is what is right. And so they accepted it. So yes, what we are doing in mediation is we are trying to ensure that there is a balance of power. They understand what they are doing. Unless it's totally illegal, we don't allow it. But otherwise, if they are prepared to accept a certain position, I think it's fair enough.
In continuation to that question, may I ask one question, Manjula?
Yeah.
Yes, yeah, please.
To Uma ma'am only. How to ensure minimal negative intrusion on behalf of family, friends, even lawyers sometimes, hampering building up of the self-efficacy that is the fulcrum of getting to yes?
The most important thing, I think, is that we respect the parties and their values. See, from the beginning, although we know that they are unreasonable or there is a pressure from somebody else who's coming in, maybe an uncle or an aunt or even a friend or a neighbor who says they know better, you know, you find out what is happening there, and when it is appropriate, call them for a separate session, address their concerns, talk to them as if their values are important, and say, look, in court this may happen, so I think we would leave it to them to discuss this. See, what will happen mostly is there is a lot of inputs given by everybody, especially in 498A cases. I'm sure all of us know, everybody says go to the police station, everything will get sorted out, so they will not listen to us. In matters where there are disputes, especially with trusts or works or something, you know, it becomes an ego issue because there will be two powerful people there involved. So you have to address their status. That is why we talk about SCARF there. We say we have to understand their status. We have to see there is a consistency. We have to see whether they have authority. We have to see whether there is relatedness. We have to see whether there is fairness. So at every stage, we respect them. We say, I understand where you're coming from. I understand your emotion. You validate it. And then you respect whatever they are saying. But then say, look, in this situation, what can you do? So, you know, I think the biggest success is when, like in one case where mediation, it didn't settle. But they had gone through mediation in New Zealand also and they'd come here and it didn't settle. And at the end of it, the husband stood up and said, thank you, madam. I felt the whole proceeding was neutral and I felt that I was heard. And I think that's where it's, you know, the mindset change starts. Then they will think about it and come back with, that's why I always leave it open at the end saying, okay, you've not been able to settle, but thank you for participating and coming this far. If you change your mind, you can still ask for mediation and come back. So you leave the door open for them, they'll come back.
Manjula,
One more question. Though there's nothing, it has not been addressed to any of the speakers, but Mr. Mansoor Ali wants to know that keeping in view of multifaceted communication in mediation process, can we develop a foolproof system to allow the parties in person to endorse their submission before the mediator, maintaining their secrecy of facts?
If I can answer this, I can only say today, like ADR, ODR and all, think about having parties separately. They don't bring them together until they have definite options which would look like settlement, which is called a shuttle mediation. But in our society, they will start suspecting that we are not neutral. So it's a very difficult call. Looking at the parties and the situation, I think we tell them, yes, I have got these facts. Can I share some of them? Even if they give permission, you tell them, I'm going to share some of those facts only when it is necessary. And you choose the right opportunity and time to do that. See, you need not carry the proposal from one person to the other person immediately. You can sound them out. Like for various reasons, they may make an offer. The next day, they may come back and say, no, I don't think that will agree with me. And so you would like, I mean, it look to the parties as if you have made the suggestion, not the other party. At one extreme experience I had was where this man had made a proposal, and next time he came back and said, no, I didn't do it. So I said, no, you did it, but it's okay if you want to change your mind, but you can't say you didn't say that. So he went on repeating it, and when he understood that I was not going to accept it, he said, madam, when did I say that? It was at before noon, because I have diabetes, my sugar level would have dropped, and that's how you got that concession from me. So next time when he came back, I used to ask him, what is your sugar level now? So that is a kind of, you know, rapport you build up when you start talking to them. And yeah, they understand. But that is why the ground rules are important. You tell them that you are in control of the process. You will decide what is the facts or communication that is going to be made. You will control how the dialogue goes on. And then when they go through the process, once they understand that, and the change becomes smooth. That is why I said, we have to understand the cognitive part, we have to understand the motivational part, we have to understand the affect part. We move slowly, stage by stage. We don't go directly into problem solving. That's very important.
Manjula, will you ask? There is one question for Mr. Sunil Agarwal.
Yes, yes.
In order to ensure privacy and secrecy, can we ask the other party in one-to-one session and to rejoin after the meeting with one party is over? I mean, after telling them that we are going to do it.
Right from the start, we should start with the one party only.
No, that is not specifically said in the question.
There is a provision to have old caucuses, either of the parties, or with both parties individually.
So that is there already.
That is there already.
Okay.
Initially, we start with a joint session, and as and
when definitely.
Sufficient facts emerge, we hope to focus with one party and then with the other party.
One more question, sir, for Mr. Agarwal. This is rushing for settlement by drafting and finalizing. Will it not amount to rushing the settlement on them or the parties without giving them time to think overnight?
Actually, there is no question of thrusting the settlement. It only happens in cases where we have been discussing the terms over some period of time, and parties actually have worked on them. And the draft settlement has earlier been drafted and shared with the parties. It is only when it is being finalized and just before being posted to them that we share the screen so that final touches are given. Otherwise, parties are given sufficient time to think over and finalize their terms. There is no question of thrusting. After all, it is the party's settlement.
Thank you, sir. Sangeeta ji, do you have any other question?
One question from Prabha Swami.
Yes.
It is questions for Sunil Agarwal, Mr. Sunil Agarwal. Can mediators use WhatsApp calls to conduct mediation in view of the low bandwidth? And will it have any impact on the proceedings regarding the external challenges?
No. I don't think it will have any adverse impact on the mediation process. These are just the mediums, either the Cisco WebEx or maybe Zoom or correct. WhatsApp call. Only facts are that the parties should be visible and audible to each other, and they should be able to hear out each other.
One more question for Mrs. Uma Ranganathan ji. This is like, how does mediation affect the psychology of an individual positively as compared to litigation that affects negative impact on the parties?
See, I think, why do parties come in to court? Most of them want to be heard or their concerns addressed. See, it's basically everybody wants to feel secure. They feel threatened in their space. So in litigation, what happens is sometimes even when they go to their lawyer and tell them this is what has happened and I want this relief, the lawyer may say the statutes are like this, so you will get only this relief, and the whole thing goes out of the party's control. But whereas in mediation, when they come and they start talking, I think the way the mediator handles their emotions, that validation of those emotions, they will understand that, yeah, they had come asking for something, but maybe that is not the right thing. They would be able to accept something else. But that process, when it happens, when there's an empathetic listening and there is a proper reframing of the whole conversation that has happened, what happens is the parties are able to move out of that. Because see, what happens, even as a child, you would have seen any child which falls down will look around to see whether anybody is seeing and doesn't start crying aloud. Once that is addressed, the second time the child will not cry as loudly as the first time. Even for us, if we get angry with somebody, even our subordinate, and for something that has not been done, say, and then you're so angry, you're yelling. If that person is in front of you, you will yell at them very badly. But if the person comes back a little later, you may not be yelling so loudly because that moment has passed. So that is why in mediation, what happens is you give them that space. That is why we say we need a closed space. We need a place where we have to have eye contact and all that. Now in the virtual space, it is going to be different. But we have to ensure, as I said, that we respect them. We make them understand that we have listened to them. By listening, I'm not just saying that we listen to the facts. Listening that what is hidden underneath, what is their expectation, what is their experience. That is why I said about those entitlements and experiences and all that. They are very, very important because they come with a particular, they come from their background. And there are certain values and beliefs which are basic to them. You cannot challenge it saying, how can you say this? So you'll have to slowly shift them from that position. So that is where those listening techniques also are very, very important. And that is why in mediation, more than anything else, they feel validated. Even if they don't get what they primarily start out with, they are able to get. That is why Herbert Simon, in his Nobel Prize acceptance speech, he says, he has coined the word satisficing. So he says, what is good enough is good. So that is what I think they ultimately take, what is good enough. And I think once that satisfaction level has come, then we have achieved something.
I think Manjula, it is time to go for the vote of thanks. We are running out of time.
Thank you. Thank you for those very good questions.
Unmute. Manjula, unmute.
I think, okay.
Yes.
So thank you, Sangeeta. Mr. Sunil Agarwal, Additional District and Session Judge and in charge District Delhi Mediation Center. Mrs. Uma Ramanathan, Advocate, Mediator and Mediator Trainer. I'll just add that Mrs. Uma Ramanathan has trained me also as an Advocate, Trainer, Mediator. It's my privilege and honor to propose vote of thanks on behalf of all the advocate mediators of Supreme Court of India and on behalf of myself too. We are grateful to Mrs. Uma Ramanathan for giving the insight of the psychodynamics of mediation so beautifully. She has nicely explained the concept of self-determination also and allowing the parties to give them confidence and take their own decisions. From her vast practice experience, she has explained the psychodynamism, that is how it is necessary for the parties to face each other, get them comfortable to participate, understand their own conflicts, and finally decide their own disputes. This technique discussed by her is indeed unique, easy, and full of practicability. Very rightly, you have said, Mrs. Uma Ranganathan, that mediation is an ongoing learning process. So we keep learning till the end of, we are in practice. online mediation has come to stay now. And it is fast becoming order of the day, more so due to the present situation, COVID-19. All of us mediators are facing various difficulties and challenges in our online mediation. We are thankful to Mr. Sunil Agarwal, Judge in Charge Mediation Center, having approximately 70% success rate in mediation to share with us the practical mediation, practical difficulties which mediators are facing in online mediation and giving us solutions thereof. Some of the challenges faced in online mediation, like lack of computer knowledge amongst the mediators and the parties also, communication with parties, bringing them on online platform, maintaining confidentiality and secrecy during the process of online mediation, preparation, signing and filing of settlement agreement and successfully handle them has been beautifully explained by Mr. Agarwal. Thank you very much, Mr. Agarwal, for sharing your valuable valuable time and giving us tips for handling online mediation easily and successfully. That is going to help, I believe, all the mediators who are now doing mediation online. I take opportunity to thank all the participants who have attended today's lecture series. Their enthusiasm and involvement is adorable and appreciable. Your enthusiasm and participation has inspired us to run this series and motivated us to bring something different and new in next lecture series. Last but not the least, I convey our special thanks to Mr. Rahul, who has been a backbone of this lecture series.
Have to thank you.
His sincerity, technical and mechanical support helps us to run this program smoothly. Thank you very much, Rahul. Thank you once again.
Thanks.
Once again, my heartfelt thanks to all the speakers, all of the Supreme Court Mediation Group participants and all others who have been and are in the background of this program. Hope and wish to see all the participants in next lecture series also, which is coming up very soon. Once again, thanks. Thank you very much. Thanks from
thank
my
you
heart.
Thank you all.
The participants and everybody associated with this program. Thank you.